Thank you. I just have to say it's such an honor to share the stage with some of my heroes, literary heroes and heroes in just the way they live their lives. So thank y'all for being here today. I'm going to read a little bit from the beginning of the novel I'm finishing right now. I'm struggling with the third act, and so I figure if I read it in public, it might force me to finish it. I don't know. It's set shortly after a cataclysmic event. It's a speculative novel after a water shortage. Even when Seamus was a puppy, he was allowed to roam free on the island where he grew up. Every day he had the same routine. He awoke at his place beside the man's bed and trotted down the hallway, across the kitchen, and out the special little door that had been cut into the big door just for him. It's set in Ireland, by the way. Once outside, he yawned and stretched in the morning sun, took in a deep breath of the salt air, and eyed the sky to see what kind of day lay ahead. Usually some gulls were frolicking about, and he ran out into the field below the house to chase them, even though he knew he could not jump high enough to snatch them. Oh, but he would like to. Those gulls had a grand old time making fun of him because he couldn't fly like them. They always wheeled away over the sea, laughing at his expense. Then he meandered on down to the fields that were hemmed in by stone fences. He knew a narrow crevice where he was able to squeeze through, although the older he got, the tighter it became. And then he was able to run the cows around the rectangle for a bit of fun until one of them got fed up and stopped prancing and faced him down. At that, he squeezed back through the slender gap and went on down to the beach to see if anything interesting had washed ashore in the night. Very often, there were carcasses of dead fish that made for a nice long sniffing, but lost his interest within a few minutes. Sometimes, there were colored bottles that made a nice music if he kicked them around on the sand. A few times, there had been shoes that had docked ashore. He liked to grab their laces and sling them around for a while before he decided to carry them home, but he usually gave up before he had left the water's edge because he decided the work wasn't worth it. There were shoes to chew on at his own home if he took the notion. Lobsters, starfish. Once there had been an entire ribeye steak, only slightly greened with rot, which Seamus practically swallowed whole. Beach balls, both inflated and flattened. A baby doll with a white dress and bonnet. The best things, however, were the sticks, especially the driftwood, because even the bigger ones were light, easy to carry. Once he had struggled home with a piece of driftwood twice as long as him and dropped it on the porch with a plump that made his man laugh and give him a treat. After his morning rambles, Seamus usually went back to find his man, offering him breakfast. Seamus's man was called Finn by others, but most often Seamus thought of him simply as his man. Each morning after he had roved out, he sat for a time near his man's feet as his man took breakfast or read the morning papers. Later, they worked in the garden together. Before tea, they had a nice nap, and the man allowed him to hop up on the couch and curl up at his feet. These were the best times. By the time night rolled across the water toward them, Seamus was served his bowl of supper while the man ate his at the table. They watched some television together, and when the night was fully dark, they went out onto the stoop where his man had his single cigarette of the day with one hand and scratched Seamus's head with the other as they watched the moon drift over the sea. Ah, 'tis a good life all in all, the old man said, nearly every night. Only occasionally he remained silent, and on those nights his eyes had water on them, and Seamus knew he was pining for some past the dog didn't know about. His man had gotten him as a puppy, and they were devoted to one another. The old man was alone. Nobody ever came to see him. He wore a ratty old chocolate-colored cardigan all the time, and in recent years, he had started using a cane. They were very happy together there on the island. They hardly ever left, but once a month they rode the shiny red ferry over to the mainland. The man had a car parked at the dock, and Seamus got to ride in the front seat where he navigated, sometimes with two paws on the dashboard, where he became particularly excited about their destination. He had to sit in the car when his man went into the grocery, but he was allowed to go into the pub. Everyone in there was always happy to see them. They clapped his man on the shoulder, and they all clicked their small glasses together and said, "Sláinte, Finn," before sliding the whiskey down their throats. In the pub, they also all knew Seamus by name, and the running joke was that they had brought their beers or glasses up into the air and called out a toast to him, and after that, they brought their beers or glasses back down to the bar. They'd laugh, and someone would shout, "Now give us a poem, Seamus," and they'd all laugh some more. The man had named him Seamus after his favorite poet. They lived like that for many years. Then the soldiers came to the island, and the man didn't allow Seamus to roam anymore. His little door within the bigger door was screwed shut, and he was only allowed to go out if his man was with him, and then only in the small bit of grass right behind the house. He missed the beach and the cows. The gulls still came to taunt him, of course. But then the man had told him he couldn't bark anymore, and his man began to do something he'd never done before, rolled up a newspaper and swatted Seamus on the rump any time he barked. For weeks, every day, all day, the man trained him not to bark, sometimes by swatting his rump with the newspaper, and sometimes by giving him a treat when he didn't bark at things that usually made him do so, the man rapping his knuckles on the kitchen table, the man saying aloud, "Is someone there?" The gulls making a racket out on the grass. Once the man had gotten on his knees with the water on his eyes and took hold of Seamus's face and said, "Listen to me, lad. If you are to survive, you must not bark." Seamus didn't know what he meant. When the winter came, the skies stayed gray for 3 solid months. The cold wind blew up from the sea, colder than it had ever before. The man watched the world from binoculars and listened to the radio all the time. The electricity went out, but he had a radio that played when you wound it up with a little handle, and his man listened with his ear close to the speaker. Now he was allowed to sleep in the bed with his man every night. They lay curled up together, and even when the planes flew over low and loud in the middle of the coldest nights, Seamus did not bark. Then all they had to eat was what the man had saved from the garden and what they had in their pantry. They mostly had potatoes, for the islanders had planted as many as they could as soon as they knew the hard times were coming, but the yield had not been as grand as they had hoped, and what they had left now were more rotted than not. Every day, there was less. And so, in the last days, they were alone, the entire island to themselves. Even the soldiers had left, although the planes still flew over, very low, watching. One day, when the man said he was feeling very well, they took a walk. They went up to the high cliffs where they could see the mainland. Seamus's man studied what was happening over there through his binoculars. "No one about," he said, more to himself than Seamus. It was a lovely day, a day Seamus would never forget. The winter had moved on and spring was in full fury. The gorse was blooming as yellow as the butter they used to have. The sun was warm on Seamus's back, and when his man tired out, they laid down for a while in the grass and let the sunlight soak into their skin. Seamus could smell the salt and the sand, the yellow of the gorse, the sweetness of the grass, the chicory of the driftwood, the musk of his man. Occasionally, his man reached over and gave Seamus's head a scratch or ran his hand down the dog's side. "Oh, Seamus, I'm thankful you're here with me," he'd say. "You're a good old man, you are." There was nothing but the wind and the sea and the sunshine that day. All of the houses stood empty, even the pub down near the pier, which was empty as well. They had been alone on the island for a long while now, but never before had they felt so alone. Yet Seamus didn't mind that he and his man were the only ones on the island. As long as he had his man, he was happy. Somehow, as they walked home, Seamus knew it was the last time he would ever have such a walk with his man, who had to sit down on the fences lining the road several times. After that day, they stayed inside all the time. His man became very thin, very gray-skinned. His hair stood in wisps of cottony white now. He lay in the bed and coughed. He ate the last of the canned food and always gave Seamus exactly half, beans mostly, sometimes marrow fat peas. When he was still able, his man took the screws out of the little door within the bigger door. He pointed at it and said, "Do not leave until you have to. Do you understand, Seamus?" Seamus tilted his head, not understanding. "Only when you have to. Do you hear me?" Seamus heard, but he didn't know what he meant. One morning, Seamus awoke and the old man did not. Seamus licked at his face for a time, but still, his man didn't move. He nudged at his man's hand and then his face with his wet nose, yet his man was as still as the fish carcasses and shoes that used to wash up on the strand. He was still as a piece of driftwood. Seamus lay atop his man's chest with his chin atop his two front paws and looked at his man for a long while. He whined every once in a while. He laid there with his man for many hours through the entire night and the next day, telling him goodbye. And then, when it was dark again, by cover of night, he zoomed through the little door within the bigger door and trotted out into the great world. Thank you.